Welcome back, everyone, to Seeker Plus. This is episode 3 in a 3-episode series on surgeries. If you missed the first couple episodes, go check them out. We talked about how far surgery has come since the days of drilling holes into people's skulls to let evil spirits out. So obviously we've come a long way. And we broke down some of the most interesting surgeries out there. But today I'd like to look to the future. What kind of megadroid super surgeon is going to be fixing me up in 10 years, 50 years, or, well, I hope really 100 years. It probably won't surprise you to learn we already have some robots in the operating room, and they're pretty good. I mean, they're especially incredible at minimally invasive surgeries because a robot can make a tiny incision and operate without having to cut a hole big enough for a surgeon to fit their hand into. This means smaller scars and less exposed areas. A surgeon working with a robot can have better precision, flexibility, and control with whatever procedure they're doing. In fact, surgeries with robots have lower infection rates for patients. It can also mean less pain and less blood loss, and all of this leads to faster recovery and better survival rates, which is obviously the whole goal. The key point here, though, is that these robots aren't operating on their own. They're remote controlled. It's like a video game played by the surgeon, like a really, really high stakes video game. Don't worry though, if you've ever played Surgeon Simulator, it's nothing like that. It's actually precise and not maddeningly frustrating and obtuse. There are autonomous surgery robots in the works though that wouldn't need a surgeon to actually be pulling the levers and pressing the buttons. Now, most of these autonomous robots work with static body parts like bones in hip or knee surgeries, but soft tissue is trickier. One self-controlled bot, known as the Smart Tissue Autonomous Robot, or STAR, repaired a pig's small intestines. It performed the surgery using all of its own vision, tools, and intelligence. And when comparing the robot's sutures with a human surgeon's, the robot's stitches were more consistent and evenly spaced. They also held up better and leaked less. This robot is like a long, flexible arm with a rotational head, and it holds the needle, thread, and force sensor. The roboticist had a hard time mimicking the sewing motion of a surgeon's hand, so this robot works more like a nail gun, lining up the needle and shooting it through the tissue. It guides itself with calibration based on 3D images from small cameras on the head. The researchers behind STAR said they see a future operating room of robots operating on their own with supervision by a surgeon. But one of my favorite visions about the future is less about large auto robots that cut people open and root around, and more about tiny autonomous robots. These are nanobots so small they can get into your bloodstream and travel straight to the source of the problem and fix the body from the inside out. I mean, talk about minimally invasive. That's it. There's no incision required. But the barrier to integrating both big and small autonomous robots, according to scientists, is that it's hard for robots to recognize and respond to soft tissue, which is all of the gooey stuff that we'd need them to fix. So what's next is to design robots that have a hypersensitive sense of touch. One project on this is giving their bots an artificial skin sensor of sorts. That way a robot could feel the difference between different organs rather than following a program or using cameras that it would have to interpret the images from. Still, AI is not at the point yet where machines can autonomously make the same decisions as an experienced surgeon, which is why the future of surgery is less about replacing surgeons and more about giving them better technology to use. That's not to say artificial intelligence doesn't have a place in medicine at all. It's a tool that just keeps getting better. Today, hospitals can analyze data collected from surgeries worldwide to help them predict outcomes for their patients. In particular, there are systems being developed that allow a doctor to collect genetic information from a patient's blood and then run it through a database to see how that individual is likely to react to surgery, medicines, and anesthesia. This alone can help the success rate of surgeries and help surgeons prepare for specific scenarios. AI could even one day monitor the surgeons themselves to make sure that they're in tip-top shape and warn them if it senses they're about to make a wrong move. Now, something that's really annoying for a surgeon, I've read, obviously I don't know from experience, is when they can't clearly see into a patient's body. You'll remember this was a huge issue at the beginning of medical history. We talked about it in episode 1, about how being able to visualize the inside of a human body was a huge leap forward for surgeons, so they actually knew what they were dealing with when they sliced into someone. The whole field improved so much just from pictures and textbooks, and then again from dissecting cadavers. Today, we have even more tools for this. There are artificial 3D models that bleed when they're cut, so surgeons can practice on those. They can also experience new surgeries in virtual reality. Even just the ability to watch videos of surgeries happening worldwide has made for better surgeon education all around. But funny enough, something so simple is still a massive issue for surgeons, and that is lighting. Not having enough light or having light that causes glares or shadows isn't just annoying. It can mean not seeing something critical mid-operation, and it could be the difference between life and death. That's why it's kind of surprising that the lighting in operating rooms hasn't evolved much in the last decade. To remedy this, electronics engineers have partnered with Mayo Clinic to make smarter lights that use machine learning and cameras to analyze and alter the intensity and direction of light for surgeons. One day, these lights may be able to respond to voice commands and react to movement in the room. In fact, turning the entire operating room into a kind of smart house, you know, like that old Disney Channel movie, it's basically the whole idea. If the room can respond to voice commands or even follow clues with its own intelligence, it could automatically clean surfaces, zap germs with UV, even prep machines for intake of organs as they're removed or set aside temporarily. But having all this technology involved in surgeries, well, it's making some people nervous. They wonder about robots having a glitch or malfunctioning, or where blame should be placed if a surgery or diagnosis by a non-human goes wrong. For a lot of people, the whole goal of medicine should be more about preventing people from needing surgery in the first place. But because the practice is advancing so much since the early days, surgery has gotten so much better, at least we can get more confident that the procedures of the future will really be incredible and safe. We could get into the future of medicine and preventative care on another episode if you like. But for now, we're going to leave it at that. Thank you so much for tuning into Seeker Plus. I'm your host, Julian Huguet. If you like this series, make sure to like, comment, share, and of course, subscribe. We'll be making a lot more of these going forward, so please let us know what topics you want us to cover. We can do anything. It's up to us. We could talk about blockchains or futuristic airplanes or brewing champagnes. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.